Theories of change is the topic, and as I understand it, theories of change really have four primary uses in philanthropy. The first is to help individuals or organizations plan programs. The second is to help them evaluate programs. The third is to enrich consultants like myself, and I'm married to one, so I can say this. And the fourth is to befuddle grantees or to enrage grantees. And the thesis of this afternoon's talk is that theories of change are especially good at doing numbers 3 and 4, but really not so hot at doing numbers 1 and 2. And we'll talk about some of the reasons for this, but I could give you a hint. Really, the primary reason is that a theory of change, ultimately, is a prognostication. It's a long-term prognostication about how the world will unfold once we've started our particular intervention in it. And whereas fortune-telling has been discredited in other domains, it has not yet been discredited in philanthropy. The primary motivator I have to give a couple of disclaimers. First, I realize that there are quite a few of you in the room who have used theories of change, have actually profited from them, and I myself have. We use them in my own shop. I understand that there is a tribe of Kazakhs living in the Sakhalin highlands who use them on a regular basis. But there are some things you should keep in mind before you do. Theories of change may cause headache, vomiting, or dizziness. Do not use theories of change if you are operating heavy machinery, and ask your personal metaphysician if theories of change are right for you. This talk was inspired, or rather I should say provoked, by an article that appeared in the Stanford Social Innovation Review issue of spring 2010, an article written by Paul Brest, president of the Aquila Foundation, and the title of his particular article was called The Power of Theories of Change. And in this article, he argued not only that theories of change were essential, but that we should be requiring them of our grantees. We should be requiring our grantees to articulate very explicit and very detailed theories of change. And he took a number of our colleagues in the philanthropic field, very smart people like Bill Shambra and Bill Somerville, to the woodshed for being skeptics about theories of change. And I have to say, I share their skepticism. And I hope to have you share a little bit of that skepticism after we get through today. What is a theory of change? This is a $64,000 question. If you look at the literature, both online and paper, remember what paper literature looks like? Actual scholarly articles. I have to pull them off the stacks of libraries. If you look at the literature, you'll find that there's not a lot of consistency in what a theory of change is. People have very different feelings, very different beliefs about what they are. In a Grantcraft publication, for example, Grantcraft used to be with the Ford Foundation, we're told that a theory of change describes a process of planned social change. Notice that this isn't really a definition of what a theory of change is, it's telling us what a theory of change does. And of course, something that describes a planned process of social change could be a novel, could be a poem, it could be just about anything, and the authors admit that there is a lot of ambiguity in the way that we use this expression, for later on they tell us that really it can be anything from a detailed map to a general storyline. You will find another author saying that the theory of change is something that defines all of the building blocks required to bring about a given long-term goal. You have to wonder what those blocks are and how you put the building blocks together. Paul Brest himself, in his article, defines the theory of change this way. He says it's the empirical basis underlying any social intervention, which sounds like a building block in definition a little bit. I don't know about you, for me, the empirical basis underlying my social intervention is the world. The way the world behaves and the world itself are what underlie our interventions. So is the world a theory of change? How do we make sense of these definitions? This is one of my favorites. It's one of my favorites because it kind of mimics the effect of snorting whippets. The product of a series of critical thinking exercises that provides a comprehensive picture of the early intermediate state changes in a given community that are needed to reach a long-term goal articulated by the community. And one of the interesting things about theories of change, besides the fact that they confuse the heck out of people, these definitions, is that there's not a lot of unanimity about whether a theory of change is the same thing as a logic model. You'll find some authors telling us that a logic model is exactly the same thing as a theory of change, and others telling us, no, 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 they're completely different things. I'm going to go with the what I've heard or what I've learned from scholars in the field. I'm going to go with the idea that a logic model and a theory of change are very different things. A logic model is this kind of table of, you know, inputs, outputs, outcomes, assumptions, and so on, that you see right here. A theory of change, I'm going to go to the real experts. And this is your grantee after you've given him all the definitions of a theory of change. Now, this is a rather sanguine reaction. Other grantees' reactions might be more violent. So what is the theory of change? What do the experts tell us? And by the experts, here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking about people who have advanced degrees, and I'm thinking about people who write scholarly articles in peer-reviewed journals, and I'm looking to them for a definition of the theory of change. When you look at the literature, what you find is that very few people use the expression theory of change at all. As a matter of fact, the most of the scholarly articles I've seen use something called, an expression called program theory. And it sounds very technical, but a program theory, you should be very familiar with. It's essentially a series of causes and effects where your intervention in the world, or your continuing intervention in the world, is the initial cause, which leads to an initial effect, which is itself the cause of another effect, which is itself the cause, and so on and so forth, until you finally reach your hoped for outcome. And you've seen theories of change defined in this sense, illustrated in many ways. This is a typical way where you have A, arrow B, arrow C, meaning A leads to B, or A causes B, causes C, etc., until you get to your outcome. Okay, enough theory for now. So how do you apply this, or how are we supposed to apply this in real world example? Suppose that you're the executive director of an organization called Parks Incorporated, and your mission as an organization is to create parks within walking distance of people's homes. And you go to neighborhoods, you have neighborhood charrettes where people participate in the design of a park, you buy public land, you convey it for a private purpose or public purpose, you get the city to maintain the park, you do all the right things. On the assumption that if you do these things, that neighborhood residents are going to use the park, and there's going to be better health outcomes, greater social cohesion, et cetera, and you've done this all over the United States. And you're very confident about this, so you send in your proposal to the XYZ Foundation, and you get an email back asking you what your theory of change is. And, I'm sorry, this is the proposal that you sent in. We propose to create a park in neighborhood X, so residents can use and enjoy it. This will lead to better health outcomes. And here is the email that you get that asking you what your theory of change is. And you think you know where your program officer might be coming from on this particular question, because after all, you've included all the information you think you need to include about your theory of change in your proposal. You've described the process. What else do you need to know beyond that? But you need the money desperately, and so you create a theory of change based on the model I showed you earlier that looks like this. If we create a park within walking distance of neighborhood homes and residents participate in the design of the park and the city commits to its upkeep, and these things, by the way, over a period of time, you've discovered are necessary conditions for bringing about your desired change that the residents will actually use the park. So you send that in, your program officer seems very happy. She gives you a large grant. Some time passes, let's say a year later, you do your evaluation, and to your horror, you discover that residents aren't using the park. They're not using the park. And you're not going to go back to your theory of change to figure out why residents are not using the park, because actually you did everything that your theory of change says you were going to do, and you checked on all those things. But what you do is you ask residents, right? Why aren't you using the park? And they tell you that they're afraid to use the park. They're afraid to use the park because drug dealers have set up shop in the park and you don't feel safe taking yourself or your family to the park, right? And your program officer gets wind of this and she says to you, hey, you're going to have to do something about this. people don't feel safe in the park, and you had your theory of change all wrong. Actually, your theory of change should have looked more like this. Right? You have to create the park within walking distance, residents have to participate, the city has to commit to its upkeep, and residents need to feel safe in the park. So you update your theory of change accordingly, and you do what your theory of change tells you what you think you need to do, and you take steps to make the park safe. So what you do is you send in the police arrest the drug dealers, they put new lighting in the park, and they station a squad car at every entrance to the park and every exit. And sure enough, people feel safer going to the park, and they take their children there, and you wait some time, time passes, a year later you evaluate, and what happens? To your horror again, you discover that people are no longer using the park. And you're not going to you're not going to go back to your theory of change because you've done everything. You've polled residents, and they do feel safe when they're in the park. What happens is that now they don't feel safe walking from their homes to the park because the neighborhood has changed, because a very unsavory element has moved into the neighborhood, and there is now gun violence on the street and people drinking beer, and it's gotten pretty bad, so people don't stay. Feel safe walking from their neighborhoods to the park, and you wonder whether you're going to get an email from your program officer telling you that you have to update your theory of change, right? So that not only do all of these other things need to happen, but also residents need to feel safe walking from their homes to the park. Oh well, it's gotten ridiculous. So let's draw a few lessons from this very, very simple example. We'll look at a slightly more complex example. First of all, the most relevant parts of your theory of change, your grantee's theory of change, was already in your proposal. And what happened to that theory of change is that life happened. Life is very complex, you can't predict all of its turns, you try as best you can, but really life happened. But essentially, your initial idea that if you create a park which is a wonderful resource, people are going to want to use that resource. Nothing more needs to be said. Second thing to keep in mind, that really articulating all of the conditions that were necessary for your theory of change to go through would have been an impossible task. In general, you can't even know what those conditions are going to be until you actually try. And as you saw in the example, we kept backtracking to fill in our theory of change rather than having our theory of change guide our actions. And these are some of the ways that you build in theory of change. Your theory of change is not helping you to plan your work. Your theory of change is not helping you to evaluate your work. You evaluate your work by asking people who are part of the intervention, why didn't it work? And really, in general, you are not, your theory of change is not working for you. You are working for it. Imagine a more slightly complex example. Here you are the board chair, let's say, of a managing board of a public housing development. And you send in this proposal. In order to improve conditions, property conditions of public housing project X, we propose to include tenants on the managing board. Now, before you ever see anything like a theory of change, this seems like a plausible proposal, right? People who are on the managing board are, you have residents on the managing board, they're going to want to make decisions that actually benefit the housing project because those decisions are going to affect them themselves. So you have immediate plausibility that this proposal might work if various other conditions obtain. And what might a theory of change for this proposal look like? Well, actually, one was created by one of the scholars in the field, somebody whose work actually I very much admire and encourage you to look at her articles on program theories, Carol Weiss, in an article titled, How Can Theory-Based Evaluation Make Greater Headway? She proposes a theory of change that looks like this. And I want to point out a few features of this theory of change. First of all, you have kind of three, I'm going to use the laser. It doesn't make a whole lot of screen, that's good. You have a residence on the managing board, right? That's your initial intervention. This is your hope for outcome, that you have improved condition of property. And according to this theory of change, there are kind of three branches by which that might happen. First of all, if you have residents on the management board, that can lead to an increased sense of responsibility by the resident representatives. Those are the people on the managing board. That makes sense. If you have residents on the managing board, it can lead to better knowledge of sources of damage and vandalism by the board. That's true. It could also lead to an increased sense of responsibility among other residents. And if you follow one of these branches down, this increased sense of responsibility among other residents can lead to an increased willingness to report or confront vandals, can lead to less vandalism, and can finally lead to an increased condition of the property. Now think back on the example that we looked at earlier, the Parks Incorporated example. By the way, if you're feeling this, so am I. But if you look at this example, last time what we looked at was really only what happens between any two nodes on this theory of change, on this very complicated theory of change. I'm going to focus on one of those two nodes right there. That an increased sense of responsibility among other residents leads to an increased willingness to report or confront vandals. Of course, this is true if residents, even though they're feeling more responsible, don't also feel more afraid about confronting vandals because somebody might have confronted a vandal and then got their apartment or building manager or something. So think about all of the problems that we had just between two nodes and multiply them by the number of nodes or all the possibilities that this theory of change might not be on this particular very, very complex theory of change. And by the way, there are a bunch of conditions that are necessary for this theory of change to work that aren't even shown. If the residents that are on the management board don't have enough power, aren't given enough power, things are not going to go through as we're expecting. Even if you have all residents on the managing board and they don't have enough money to do what they need to do, this intervention isn't going to go through either. And then think of all of the other possible conditions that need to be met in order for this intervention to go through. And yet already our theory of change, I think, is a little unwieldy and very hard to use. There are also a number of feedback loops that aren't shown in the theory of change. So for example, if you hire more maintenance staff, that might or possibly lead to an increased sense of responsibility among other residents because residents see that there's more maintenance staff, they have more pride, they have more of a sense of ownership, and they may actually feel a greater sense of responsibility. And there are other possible connections that we haven't explored. If, after a year, the property doesn't improve, this theory of change is not going to be terribly helpful in your helping to evaluate what went wrong. Carol Weiss, in her article, actually argues that it might be helpful, and this is how she described it. She says, the small everyday steps in the diagram, all of these steps that you see here, can be couched in social science language, such as sense of communal responsibility, access to authority, local knowledge, bureaucratic responsiveness, and so on. In the conduct of the evaluation, the evaluator will need to operationalize these concepts and develop specific indicators that capture their essential meaning, and not one assumes in going through any one of these particular branches. I think that that's an incredibly expensive kind of evaluation for something that should be fairly simple, because what you need to do in this case is you need to ascertain, first of all, that the property didn't improve and how it didn't improve. And then you could simply ask why. Go to the management board and say, why didn't you take these steps to improve the property? And that'll give you, you'll learn from that. You'll be able to learn something from that. So a few things to keep in mind about this event. This theory of change that we just saw, unwieldy as it was, doesn't even begin to list all of the necessary conditions for that intervention to go through, for that success of that property. If after a year the property doesn't improve, it's unlikely the theory of change can help you in guiding your evaluation, doing your evaluation of the intervention. And finally, you can imagine many scenarios in which the property improves, but for none of the reasons shown on the theory of change. I'll show you the theory of change again. Imagine, for example, if one of the residents on the management board had a brother-in-law who had a contracting company that did superb work for half the cost. Imagine that one of the residents on the management board was especially good at putting together Saturday work teams, volunteer work teams, to help spruce up or improve the property. Imagine any number of things. And you only find out whether these things are possible really by asking the people involved and asking the right questions. It's unlikely that you're going to get it from anything like this theory of change. And by the way, theories of change can get very complicated. This is one that I pulled off the internet, and I have actually seen much more complicated theories of change than this, enough to set your head on fire. All right, so what do you do? Here's my suggestion. I suggest that we apply something called what I call the plausibility test, and many of you already do this. It's a very simple one. Imagine that you have an applicant or a grantee who's proposing to improve the quality of the water in the Chesapeake Bay by reading poetry to it. It doesn't seem terribly plausible. Imagine that you have an applicant who's proposing to reduce gang violence by encouraging gang members to wear styrofoam shoes. Not terribly plausible. The plausibility of the proposed intervention, I think, should be really the main measure of whether or not we want to explore funding. So this is what I would suggest you try. Don't request a separate theory of change. Read the proposal carefully, ask the appropriate questions at the site visit, find out whatever it is you need to find out, and then simply apply the plausibility test. Is it possible that the course of human affairs might be such that we will finally, given the leadership that we have, given the conditions that are present, we'll finally have the output that is hoped for? And if it seems plausible, go ahead and apply. And then test your assumption, right? Evaluate. Ask yourself this question. What beyond what is already included in the proposal do I believe a theory of change is going to bind me? And if you can't answer that question with absolute clarity, I would suggest foregoing inflicting a theory of change on your applicants or your grantees. And finally, if you must ask applicants to articulate a theory of change, encourage them by all means to keep it as simple as possible, because really that's as good as anyone can do. Everything else is kind of your fortune telling, and no matter what anybody tells you, it might be a nice exercise, it might give you some comfort, you might enjoy pulling this thing out that looks like spaghetti and going over its various notes, but I'm telling you, most of your grantees will not benefit. And so with that, I'm going to skip that and simply say thank you.